We're going to start the meeting at 6:07. I'm unfortunately taking minutes, you guys, so I apologize for that. The first thing we're going to do is go around and introduce ourselves. I'm Carolyn Ness, Board of Selectmen.
I'm Kip, also Board of Selectmen.
Skip Olmstead, Finance Committee.
Mary Stokarski, Finance Committee.
Jeff Upton, Finance Committee.
Bruce Hunter, Finance Committee.
John Pereski, Finance Committee.
Lynn Carey, Superintendent of Schools.
Bob Decker, Frontier.
Patty Kavanaugh, Business Director for Frontier and Union 38.
Janine Heil, Principal Deerfield Elementary.
Darius Mesto, Principal of Frontier.
Amy Fosner, Frontier School Committee.
Bill Mayer, PC, Frontier School Committee.
And Mary Raymond, Deerfield and Frontier School Committee.
And Trevor McDaniel, Deerfield Selectman.
Great. Lynn, how would you like to start? Would you like to go over the Frontier budget, or we did do the Deerfield budget already?
Yes, you and Skip were at the meeting, and I spoke to the Deerfield budget. We did make some cuts, and I did have to mention to the community that was assembled there that we were relying a little bit on too much on school choice, as we're decreasing our school choice students, and that revenue is flat. We need to move some of that into the regular budget.
So, Lynn, just because it's going to be, it's hard to hear, why don't you take the mic and let's back up to the Deerfield budget. You said you had made some minor cuts. Would you like to go over that?
Sure. We
not since the meeting.
Not since the meeting.
No. In preparation to present this budget to you, we brought it forward last Wednesday, March 1st.
Yep.
And we brought it in an open meeting. You and Mr. Camoza and Mr. Olmstead were there, and we talked about some of the cuts that we made to help alleviate our dependence on school choice funds. Mm-hmm. And so that is the budget we're presenting for Deerfield, Deerfield Elementary.
Is that the one March 1?
Yes, it is. That was done last week. And
I know Bruce and Jeff and John were there. Did you all have any questions?
I got there after it was discussed.
Oh, okay. Did you have any questions?
Based on this?
Well, the presentation that they did on Wednesday.
I missed it. I got there too late.
Okay. Oh, okay. Did you have, looking over the budget, did you have any questions, John, that came to mind?
Maybe it's obvious, but the number of students, page 7, is approximately the same,
mm-hmm.
but school choice is down, so I assume... Do these students include school choice?
Yes.
So then the decrease in school choice is made by Deerfield students, then, right? To bring it back up to where it was?
Correct.
Okay.
The anticipated low enrollment that we've been expecting hasn't come to fruition. We're still getting our kindergarten enrollment for native Deerfield children is high. It's not as low as they predicted it would be. So. As our sixth grades matriculate and our school choice leave, we're not bringing in that many in to the lower grades to keep the number of school choice students the same. So the hope that at some point, although we may need 3 kindergartens because we have an enrollment of 50, when they get to a higher grade level, we may be able at that time to go down to 2 sections. So we might have 2 large, 22 classes of 25 at 4th, 5th, and 6th, where we need 3 sections from K through 3.
Okay, but I'm just talking total students.
Yep.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
It's going to be the same even though school choice is down.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. More native.
Native, right.
Yep.
Are we going to focus a little bit on Deerfield Elementary to start off with?
Yes.
Sure.
I wanted to follow up.
I do have some questions.
Sure.
And the reason why I'm asking is to try to get the overall big picture of where we're at to make sure that I have facts and figures right in that. So one of them I'd like to go back right away and ask about the contract cycle right now. Are we in the first year or 3-year contract?
Second year.
Second year, okay. And it's 2.5, and the third year will be?
2.5.
2.5, so it was 3 2.5s, all right. Adding the cost.
No, I'm sorry. Last year was 1%.
1%?
This year is 2.5, and then 2.5.
Okay. adding the column on the elementary contract, was that to bring that in line with Frontier contract as far as that last column?
No.
The master's 45.
I don't know. I wasn't at the table.
Yeah, what page
do you want? What they negotiated was a separate, an additional category for teachers who have had more schooling than a master's plus 30. It had nothing to do with Frontier. They're two different unions.
Right, okay. Well, I was just wondering if it was to kind of try to bring contracts in line. Because obviously with Frontier, they have, I believe it's a 45 CAGS column. And the Deerfield Elementary did not. And I was just wondering if that was kind of
that could have been,
bring teachers in line with it through negotiation.
So okay. I can speak to that because I was part of the negotiation committee. That's exactly what the union was actually asking for, that even though it's two different bargaining committees, they were asking to bring the two in line.
In line with each other.
When we were negotiating contracts, there was a disparity. That was their, their reason.
Right, which obviously makes some sense.
It makes some sense.
Right, it's relevant. As far as salary range, what's the minimum and maximum on that salary schedule? Is the minimum about $40,000, maximum around 78?
I don't have the CBA with me, and I didn't bring my computer. I could have looked it up. So. It probably starts in the high 30s, low 40s, and then it goes to,
74. It's about 74, the max.
Right, and then...
okay, we may want to check that.
You want a copy of it? We can get a copy of it.
No, you can check on the computer with the DOE, Mass DOE. It lists all the school systems as far as contracts.
But if you wanted to see the contract... Yeah. Happy.
Yeah, we.
I don't.
We don't have it. As far as class sizes for the elementary, and I understand the focus, what are those basically running?
Janine,
In the primary grades, they are between 18 and 19, and the upper grades, they are ranging from 20 to 23.
Okay. And with the, I noticed with 28 instructional aides at Deerfield Elementary, how many of those are one-on-ones? Do you know offhand? 28 instructional aides, and again, I understand the goals of education, and I appreciate them, former educator myself. So, but 28 instructional aides just seems like an awful large number.
How many classrooms do you have?
Consider all your early childhood pre-K because it's a pre-K model. So all your early childhood, there's three in the other classroom.
We have four in the LEAP program.
Mm-hmm. 1 second.
You have 21 classrooms, Janine?
20.
20 classrooms. Yeah. So 20 of them would be in classrooms.
Right.
And eight of them would be, four would be in our special education, substantially separate program called LEAP for students with multiple disabilities. And four others would be one-on-ones for students who are required to have an adult with them at all times.
Okay, great. Thank you. As far as the full-day preschool, pre-K, that was half day previously, and we're years back.
There was, I don't know, maybe 3 years back, there was a half day integrated preschool program, and then we had a full day preschool program.
Okay.
Now we have the three full day preschool programs.
Okay. How is that funded? Is that tuition based with parents?
Yes.
So all the pre-K is tuition based?
Or grant.
Not grant.
If the child is receiving special education services,
that's true.
Right.
From the age of 2.9, we are responsible. So they get so many hours to treat according to their IEP. And if they stay longer, then the parent pays. So there is that piece that is not that is like supported by the budget.
All right. Okay. Another question I had, accountability hour stipends. I wasn't too sure what that meant as far as in the contract. That was a little confusing to me.
That is, accountability hour is offered to fifth and sixth grade students. So it's similar to a detention, so to speak.
sometimes accountability hour. The students stay after school either for disciplinary reasons given by the teacher or to make up some missed work, to get some extra help, that sort of thing. The stipend covers the teachers staying the additional hour after school. All six of the fifth and sixth grade teachers rotate that, so they split that stipend over the course of the year.
Okay.
That is something that they did speak about that would be eliminated. They're considering eliminating next year, not having a need for that.
It'll be eliminated next year?
We were talking about that. I mean, the stipend for that is so small, $600 or something.
All right. Thank you. Now, let's see. On page 6 of 26, I saw something about 14 instructional assistants. How does that combine with the relationship with the 28 instructional assistants already? As far as for projected,
six.
I think it was page 6 of 26.
Mm-hmm. That was out of school choice funds.
Right. So 14 of the 28 are paid. So half of them are paid through the school choice budget.
Okay. So you're doing school choice money again. All right. Okay. And then on page 16 of 26, could you explain the difference, and there's also page 10 of 26, the difference between district-wide information management and technology in network and telecommunications?
Okay,
if we're going to address that, what is the difference between those two budgets? One is labeled district-wide information management and technology, and the other one on page 1626 is labeled as networking and telecommunications. Okay. And I was just wondering what the difference between the two were.
This is classification set forth by the chart of accounts for the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education. District-wide are things that we do to account for the total district. For example, our student information system, our eSped services.
Right.
So anything that is pertaining to
It's accountability to the state.
The district-wide, how to report to DESE.
Right, okay.
The network and telecommunications, that's our basic, our internet connections. And the infrastructure for the wireless throughout the building, those types of expenditures.
Okay, all right, because I just saw that reflected same budget areas in the Frontier budget also. Mm-hmm. So I was wondering if those were interrelated and showing up.
Well, there's
time.
Another section too, Jeff. There's the section for the classroom instruction too.
Right.
So.
Yeah, I did see that. Okay. Yes. Okay. All right. That for the Deerfield Elementary School basically ends my question, except for the fact that I'm a little nervous as far as relying on school choice, and I realize that the school committee has made efforts to address that, because at times there, a few years back, we were having more school choice students than we needed, mm-hmm. and they were pretty much running their own classroom in the town of Deerfield. Taxpayers were subsidizing that school choice. I see it working somewhat on the elementary level, but what I'm nervous about is as we transfer that into the Frontier level. And I will ask about that when we talk about the Frontier budget. All of a sudden, we're getting per grade level of school choice students being 27, 28 students. And are we once again duplicating what we did at the earlier level in the elementary at the Frontier level at the upper grades? And are we once again with the school choice students actually having more school of choice than what we need, and it's actually costing the town money instead of supplementing the budget? Because when you start getting numbers like 27, 28 per classroom, it makes me wonder that with a little creative scheduling and that, if we could be reducing staff. And I'm not out to reduce staff unnecessarily, but at the same time, budgets. As far as another thing I'd like to address down the road here is the school budget is part of the town budget. It's not a standalone. And with the school budget and the town budget, we're really starting to squeeze the town because of the cost of the school budget. And I realize there's needs and everything, but at some point, I think we have to be careful. We're starting to walk a fine line, and there's needs in other departments, and there's things in town that I think people want to try to push forward or move forward, and we simply don't have the money for. You know, at some point in time, something's going to have to give. And the only way out of it, because you don't have a lot of new growth in town, is to raise taxes. And at some point in time, there's people in town. There's some people that, yeah, they have money and they can probably afford those increases, but there's other people in town that can't afford those increases. And I'm getting a little concerned when we're looking at overall budget, town budget, we're probably a little over 70% being spent on schools. And the rest, you know, 27-28% is left up to, you know, to the rest of the departments. And that's not a lot of money. And please don't forget, when you look at numbers, please don't forget to add in the health care expense of teachers. I know that's not part of the school budget per se, but it should be included because that's compensation for the staff, for the employees. And that should be looked at as far as part of the overall budget of the school. And I'm not trying to beat up on school. All I'm trying to do is state facts. I believe in education. I believe what we're trying to do. But at some point, we just can't afford to do everything. So,
Jeff, do you think when you were talking about those 27 kids, and do you think that's probably a result of consolidation when all, you know, everybody's got a school choice like Conway?
Right. That's exactly what it is. It, you know, on the elementary, it's being managed.
Yep.
But once it moves into Frontier, all of a sudden class size, you know, now I was going to address that too later. Class size in Frontier, and then all of a sudden you're looking at 27 students or 28 school choice students per grade level.
Right.
All of a sudden you're saying, well, wait a second, are we getting back to what was happening
below
in the elementary school 3, 4, 5 years ago? And I just want us to be aware of that. I just want people to be aware of that this is, I think this is catching up to us, and I don't think we're going to be able to sustain it, to be honest with you.
Lynn, addressing Jeff's concern, we're actually dropped down a percentage, so we're only 22% school choice this year at the elementary school level. What are the Sunderland and Whately and Conway school choice percentages? Are they around? I mean, are they more than that?
Whately might be a little higher. Conway's probably lower, and yeah. Sunderland's probably about the same.
Okay, so we are talking, actually, a classroom probably.
It is. To address that too, I think we're in year three of not accepting school choice in the lower grades. Yeah. So it's kindergarten, first grade, and second grade. And I think, if I'm not wrong, Janine, that'll hit third grade next year. So the third grade students would be the first class that we didn't take, unless they were siblings of someone who was school choice.
Yeah. Or employees,
yep.
Which
right.
is all
yeah. Right. Yeah. Yeah. So, but the irony is, especially particularly in kindergarten, our numbers are kind of really expanding.
Right.
We've been talking a lot about declining enrollment, and now our kindergarten is quite huge. And the difference with that, too, these students that are coming in are just harder students to teach. They just come in with a lot of different learning styles that we need to adjust to them so that we can reach them. There are many kids that have some serious issues, and we've done a lot of work this fall in meeting those needs. So
that's impacting the preschool budget, because if they have IEPs, then we pay the tuition. Is that correct?
Well, we don't really pay the town. Tuition to ourselves, but we have the budget has to support the cost of those services.
Okay. So I guess when, at what point in the, on the preschool are we supporting, not, the preschool is not supporting itself? I mean, are we getting to that point?
I think that we're maybe 50%.
It's going to get worse because the funding, we lost it. We lost the grant. In the governor's budget, he reduced it by 6,000 this year. And next year, it's a $30,000 grant hit. And this was the grant that we've had for many, many years that started out years ago to help working parents to keep the child past the school days. Well, they feel that nobody's doing that, so it's a redundant grant because we are getting foundation enrollment money for the students that have to attend pre-K. We get a half a student in the foundation enrollment. So they've done away with that grant. So the budget will be picking up more and more of the cost of the pre-K.
The grant will go away in 2020. We're losing 6,000 this year. We'll have 30,000 until 2020. But that's years. But we need to be planning ahead for that. We also lost a kindergarten grant this year, and we needed to put curriculum coordinator for early childhood, our early childhood special ed specialist, off the grant into the budget as well. And our curriculum coordinator, we lost money in Title I, and so we had to move part of that onto the. The beauty of that, though, of course, it's dispersed over four schools.
Okay. I don't want to interrupt the budget talk, but at the end of the meeting, I would like to address some of the advocacy issues that maybe we can, you know, how do we organize, how do we get things. I didn't really, Friday at our Mass Municipal meeting, I really didn't get a clear answer from our legislators how we were going to get involved in the process for redoing the formula, the Chapter 70 formula. And, mm-hmm. you know, I don't want to miss that because I think we just, it makes sense to have kids early as possible, and we need to have as good a support program. But obviously that's, you know, costs a lot to have the intense, you know, staffing for that. So the
research will tell you that it'll absolutely. Save the town money year after year, the more students we can get in and get them early,
right.
particularly the students that need that kind of assistance.
I want to make sure that when they redo the formula, that there is some support for, you know, pre-K.
Yeah.
But anyway, it is more cost effective. So I agree with you 100%. It's just trying to bite the bullet. Okay.
I understand completely.
Bruce.
I have a question on the Deerfield Elementary School budget. Version 2 versus version 3. There were two significant changes, one in projected enrollment and the other in the increase in budget. Could somebody speak to both of those items, please?
The increase in enrollment, daily we get new students. I think the earlier version, which I don't have, had...
There was only 45 students in kindergarten enrollment at that time, and now we have 50.
Yeah,
thank
that's
you.
That's why I saw the difference.
And then the top numbers we lock in as of October 1st, because that's what our foundation enrollment will be based on. And then the projected for FY18, we do change it as the enrollment changes each month at the school.
When does it finalize? It's the first day of school?
So yes.
Exactly. Pretty much, yeah. They come in right in the
today.
First day of school, they come in the door. We welcome them all.
Does that have a significant impact on your budget? Not.
No.
Do you account for those hopefully projected?
The difference in the difference between the budget numbers in version 1 and version 2 was when we were making the reductions, we were going to have some of them come from the town appropriation and some from the school choice, and then the school committee decided that and all of them had to come from the school choice so that we can reduce our reliance, as the superintendent said, on the school choice funds. So the school committee voted to take the reductions in the school choice and not all in the town appropriation.
Well, the budget was lower in version two.
Correct.
2% increase, and that was 2.7.
What we did, the school committee was very forward-thinking on this. If we don't address the funds coming out of school choice this year, at least half of them, what we would end up with next year would be an even larger deficit because the money in school choice is going down. So we needed to start this year to take money, to take items that we were paying out of school choice and put it into the budget so that next year the hit won't be so bad. And it was, you know, I commend the principal and her team for coming up with these cuts that will help us next year. So when we're sitting at the table a year from now, it won't be so bad for the teachers and the students and the people of Deerfield Elementary School.
Yep. So, appreciate that. I think next year is going to be really tough when we get the federal cuts.
It will definitely be.
I don't even want to talk about it. Yeah, we can't even talk about it because it's so depressing.
I just foresee us at some point coming down the road here and hitting the wall.
You're right.
You know, with the direction that we're heading, we're going to have to either basically try to push the envelope and do the 2.5 override, or we're going to have to cut services.
Yeah.
It's going to have to be one or the other at some point down the road here if we continue down this road. I just don't see how we can resolve this. You know, I wish there was an easy way, and I'm sure you people do too, but there isn't, and I don't know if there's any right or wrong answer. So that's one of my concerns. I even made a little mental note here, and I jotted down regionalization for the elementary schools. You know, I'm looking at all these schools, and I'm looking at all these school choice students, and as we call them, native, students, our in-district students, is the answer possibly that? I don't know, but I think that needs to be discussed at some point in time and in some venue, and I don't know what the right venue is, but I think that discussion needs to be had.
Well, we did have a long-range planning committee, which I was really excited about, and everyone is aware that it's the charter schools that are pulling our kids out, and that is having impact on our cherry sheets. So the idea of regionalizing and having individual magnet schools, like a science and math academy somewhere in one of the buildings, is really exciting. It seemed like it was really exciting in a way to keep from leaching away from our budget, the charter school, because the charter school costs, I don't know, Patty, what is the per student cost here?
Deerfield, I have the in the Frontier presentation, I have all the charter schools. I'm not really sure off the top of my head what the town of Deerfield is paying.
Oh, no, I meant what's our per pupil cost?
$15,000.
Approximately.
It depends on what charter school they go to.
No.
Deerfield Elementary.
I just got an email late today. The per pupil expenditures were just released today, and I didn't get a chance to pull them.
Oh, okay.
But I can get that data for you tomorrow.
Okay, but some of the charter schools we're paying for are close to $20,000 or a little dash over $20,000. It's significantly more than what we pay per student here in our own elementary school.
Just to follow up on something that Jeff said, I do want everyone to be aware that even though the health costs and the health care costs aren't in the school department budget, we treat them as an indirect cost, and they get reported on the end of the year report.
So they're included
in the per pupil cost. They count towards that, as well as the contributions that are made to the Franklin County Retirement Board as well.
Are you, when you do the reporting, are you picking up our resource officer and some of the other expenses that we provide as the town of Deerfield?
That's on Frontiers, We only pay a small, we didn't pay last year, and this year we only agreed to $15,700.
Okay. Well, I know, but the town provides like health insurance for the resource officer and stuff like that, so we want to make sure that we're including that as a...
Yeah. Deerfield Academy is picking up...
The salary.
Around $30,000.
Yeah.
So, and to get back to the regionalization, which I think, I agree, I think it would, at this point, would be the best thing for the union. However, my understanding is that they've attempted it. They had meetings and they attempted and did a lot of work in going that way, and it came to naught. It just kind of fell apart because the four towns couldn't exactly agree. I think the issue was health insurance, and I believe it was in one of the other towns that they would have to pay a little higher portion of health insurance to equal what we're doing. But it certainly would make a difference. In a magnet school, I would just go on the record. If any district could do it, this district, this union could do it. We have the brains, we have the teachers, we have the curriculum in place, we have the principals, very competent and highly skilled and educated staff. So
it's just... Okay, go ahead.
Carolyn?
Yeah.
I've got two or three questions.
Sure.
And since we've been talking about the regionalization, somewhere along the way, I think it would be worth renewing that effort and even getting to the point of saying we're going to go to a vote just to see what...
Agree.
Just to see what it looks like.
If you recall...
My gut feeling is... It won't pass, but we don't know until we try.
If you recall, we did hire a consultant from UMass to look at our building use in all four towns, not just school buildings, but all our municipal buildings, because there was opportunities to share senior centers and the like, and that was never completed. And when Dr. Carey came on board, I did get in contact with George Hannum from UMass, and he said he would have a report to us by September. September came and went. And December, I just said to him again, we need our report. What is going on? Not that we've paid anything for it yet, but you all have warrant articles outstanding, I believe, not from last year's budget, but the
year before.
Year before.
It was the year before.
Because we had a meeting. I remember we had the joint meeting in Sunderland that all the towns attended, and we said nothing was off the table. So we're still waiting for that report. And I don't know if he would just call me and say, we're not doing it, and then we could move forward. But I don't want to then get a bill for something, you know, that will pay for us the work we did do. So we have been trying to follow up on that, and we're getting nowhere.
But if we made an effort to reconstitute that committee or whatever and see where it goes, I mean, it's the only thing that I can see where we can, if there is any opportunity for savings, it's only going to come through the regionalization approach.
Right.
And just a point of information for all. The Frontier Regional Agreement assesses school choice and charter kids as though they don't exist in the assessment of costs and how we determine the formula.
I know.
And in this particular budget coming forward, Conway's advantage by $70,000, to Deerfield's disadvantage by $93,000, Sutherland's disadvantage by roughly $28,000, and Dewey's advantage by roughly $51,000, because those choice and charter were not anticipated when the original agreement was done. And the original agreement talks about those students enrolled at Frontier. They're not enrolled at Frontier, yet Frontier has to pay those costs. So maybe those costs should be actually belong in the towns and let the towns take whatever the reimbursement for their charter or choice is. But right now, it's a disproportional way it's being done. And if you look at page 27-36, you'll see it on the right down there. That is spelled out for us.
I don't have it.
In the Frontier budget.
In the Frontier budget.
Yeah.
Right on the bottom.
Bless you.
Excuse me, sorry.
So, you know, granted, with the foundation budgets, Conway may take a bigger hit, but we don't control the foundation budget either.
And I know.
You know, those minimum contributions. But you know, it's a big hit. There's a disproportionate number of children that attend school choice and charter from the smaller two towns.
And basically, Jeff, that's what we look at. The map is just what we look at. But we try to make sure we have enough school choice coming in to cover the school choice and charter out. And we try to break even so that we're not. And last year, for this year, FY17, we weren't breaking even. We had an additional $70,000 of tuition than we had income. So for the first time, the $70,000 additional charter tuition had to go on the Frontier budget and be assessed to the town.
Right.
So... Okay. When you're looking at school choice, because we have to pay for the out, we look at it as a net effect.
Yeah, I understand that, but I'm also concerned about the additional staff that it support, that it takes to support the school choice. And so, you know, that's a, I think that's a little bit of a balancing act.
Well, the idea, Jeff, about the choice is basically if you have room, choice is fine. You shouldn't be adding staff just to do the choice.
Right. But as I said earlier, when you take a look at the numbers at Frontier with the number of school choice, each grade level, you know, you're looking at least according to your information here, you're looking at 27, 28 per grade level of school choice students. Does that not constitute probably another staff number?
Well, some of those children... We're sort of obligated because they were taken in the elementary school.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Right. It starts from the elementary and works its way up. And then when it, if we're not careful at the elementary level, it hits us. But then again, it hits us at the Frontier level because of what we've done in the elementary. So it just perpetuates itself all the way up through.
Because they changed their policy on how many school choice kids they took kindergarten first.
Yes.
It's going to gradually peter down.
Years.
Are we taking school choice kids in Frontier directly? Approximately how many?
Directly.
Directly, not from the elementary feeding.
So we probably get a half a dozen in seventh grade, maybe even half of the three or four eighth grade, and then another little bump in ninth grade. But at the same time, we lose the tech, so for other private high schools and charter schools, so you don't really see the numbers.
Yeah.
This year's class coming in is so large that we probably won't be able to take additional school choice without expansion. So
that means seventh grade coming in?
Seventh grade coming in is a large class, yeah.
A couple of other questions. I noticed that the cherry sheet reimbursement or cherry sheet coming in for FY18 for school choice for Deerfield dropped about $190,000. Mm-hmm. What was that?
The difference in number of students. We had, if you look on...
It didn't look like there was a substantial difference in students. And at 5,000 apiece, that would be 38.
Yeah, but that was special ed, wasn't it? Patty, you had mentioned it was special ed.
The sped increments, correct.
Right, the sped increments.
It's on the, in the narrative, Skip, I think in 6 of 26... The FY16 was based on 93 children, and the FY17 was based on 75.
And that's page 6 of 26?
Yeah, top paragraph.
Our revenue, and we spend a year in arrears, so the revenue that we got in 16, we spend in 17, and the revenue that we receive in 17, we spend in 18.
Correct.
So it's a difference of 93 and 75. Now, again, the 75 kids is just what we have at the December point. We report again in June, and that is when we add the sped increments for any student that is school choice receiving special education services and transportation.
So that's a drop of 18 students.
Mm-hmm.
90,000.
If they were all typical regular ed, that would be approximately 90,000.
Right.
So a good substantial number of special needs youngsters, either that we're not bringing in or who are moving up to Frontier. Is that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
We have three children in our LEAP program that are tuitioned in as well.
Okay.
From other districts.
We touched on benefits, and at some point in time in the next couple of weeks, I would like to come over and talk with you about benefit costs. There are a couple of items that I would like to, you know, just chat about it rather than take up time in this meeting. That's reasonable.
The last week of March would be most helpful. We're out four nights next week.
And the week after.
And you've got Friday, what's next?
That's true. No, we have a dance and a play at the high school on Fridays.
We're out, and then the following week we're out, the 20th and the 21st, so after that would be great.
It would be great to have a conversation, sure.
We'll have a handle by then on our whole budget, and so that would be good timing, actually, Skip. Okay, yes, well, we better have a handle. Okay. Is there any other questions, Bruce?
Yeah, I have one.
Oh, go ahead.
Trying to find the page. Library assistant.
Mm-hmm.
You're increasing one person, I believe, $15,000. What is the reason for that?
Janine, you want to that? You can explain if you'd like. Well, we're reducing the librarian herself to from 1.0 to a 0.8, so it'll be from 5 days a week to 4 days a week. That position is to help cover the day to keep the library open when the day the librarian's not there. Also to help support the librarian. There was a time when we had two library assistants in there. We did reduce them over the years. The other piece to that is that there is the reduction that you see of the reading tutor position. That person, we are hoping will be able to move into that. So there's a cost savings there. There's a difference in those salaries.
Thank you.
That's a follow-up. I want to follow up your question. My question was, how many additional hires have we had in the elementary school, or will we have, and how many reductions did we have in next fiscal year?
For next year?
Yes.
The only addition would be
the library assistant.
The library assistant. Was there an aide that was hired? There was an aide that was hired that was not put into the budget this year.
If you go to page 7 of 26, in the changes in the staff around that page, as well as the students, so at the budget time, when we did the budget for 17, we had 85.6 staff, mm-hmm. and what we're budgeting this year is 85.45, so it nets out a 0.15 difference.
That's FTEs, but mm-hmm. dollar value-wise, is what is the difference?
Oh, I'd have to add up all the comings and the goings. I mean,
that's fine to say there's a minor decrease, but is there really a decrease in the budget, or is there an increase in the budget? Well, moving positions from one place to another.
I guess I don't see the new library assistant position on page 7.
My understanding is the savings is $20,000.
It's more than
$20,000.
It would be the difference in the instructional assistance, Mr. Bresky. We mm-hmm. had 28, now we have 28.5. Oh. That 0.5 is the new library assistant.
Oh, she's only half time.
Under IA.
Oh, yeah.
He or she. I'm just trying to quickly total up the changes in personnel. And I'm getting $43,909, but I could be forgetting something.
Thank you.
Actually, if I look at this, no, altogether it was $85,167.
Yep. That's what.
Right. $85,167. The 43 was the piece that was.
So
the
without losing
fund.
Any staff, you were able to reduce your salary budget by $85,000.
Yes, exactly.
Same number of heads, different number of FTEs.
Yeah,
and Janine and her, she works with a group of teachers biweekly, and she came up with these cuts, and the teachers were not in favor. No one's in favor, but they worked hard.
Yeah,
and that was their goal, and they did a great job.
there any other questions before we move on to Frontier? Okay, fine. We can start.
One question.
Oh.
Total.
There's always one.
Total overall budget here for Deerfield Elementary is projected in dollars at what?
Including all sources of funding?
Yes.
$5,472,960.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Does anyone want to start with questions on the... Why don't you start a presentation, because we haven't actually had Patty a formal presentation on the Frontier budget. Okay. So instead of opening up for questions, why don't you go over the budget with, if you don't mind. Would that be okay?
That would be fine. Do you want to make any comments before I go through?
Thank you. Again, Darius and his team worked hard. Originally, of course, we have a budget committee. They sent us with a quite a large task. We were able to work with the numbers and then come back and look for some less intrusive cuts, but cuts none the same. And Darius and his team worked really hard, and they shared it with me, and they've made some good choices. Cuts are never easy. Cuts are always difficult, and they did a good job, again, keeping things in line without actually having an incredible impact on students. But they were able to collapse some costs. Thank you.
So if we begin on page 5, this is our student and staff data sheet. And this is a new page to all of our budgets this year. It's one that Dr. Carey brought with her from another district, and I absolutely love it because I think it gives us a quick snapshot of how many students and how many staff that we have. And then, so you'll see right now, well, as of October 1st, we have 611 students, and we're projecting 671, but that's if we get every sixth grader in the four elementaries. So right now, the enrollment in sixth grade is 145. Okay. As Darius had alluded, we don't always get them. At this point, sometimes they go to private school. Yeah. When they leave sixth grade, they'll go to charter school. They'll choice out to another district. So it's hard for us to tell how many we're going to get.
And you're also, your ninth grade doesn't have a tech numbers.
Right, and our ninth grade doesn't show.
The middle school students who go to private high school or Darius and charter.
Yeah.
They'll go to Franklin County Tech or Smith Folk.
So you will lose 20 kids, more or less, someplace in that ninth grade class.
I imagine next year's numbers. Right now we're at 621 is our actual number. Since this number here, we'll probably be around 630 to 635 next year, would be my guess. But it's a very large seventh grade class coming in. And so I don't know, we have to go back 12 years to look in the winters we had, but it's a bump.
Nothing like the winter of 78.
I remember that one.
Well, they're long gone. okay, so page 6 of 36. The first section, part of this section of this budget is about the actual budget, and then the second part of the packet is the assessment data. So we are requesting an increase of $311,859, or 3% increase from our last year's budget. And mostly these costs are generated from the collective bargaining agreement. The 2.5% was also the current, both contracts, Jeff, to answer your question, at Frontier and the union were 1, 2.5, 2.5. So we're mm-hmm. in the same situation. So that was $166,604, along with the steps of $69,839. We have new people that have matriculated onto the longevity schedule that will increase by $4,500. And a new stipend was given to the teachers at Frontier if they teach an advanced placement class. That's what AP means.
May I ask why that increase for advanced placement class? Does it require teachers to have an additional certification, more education, or I'm just curious?
serious, do you know? We weren't on the negotiations.
Okay. It was negotiated, and my understanding is that they do, at least once in their career teaching AP, they do take a class. And then as, for instance, I think it was European history, the curriculum was changed. They had to go back and learn that curriculum. So there is a certain level of professional development that goes along with that. We pay for the professional development, but they do take some learning to be able to teach the AP classes.
Are these stipends for teaching the class? There's a stipend?
Exactly, and each year there's three levels. So if you're in year 1 to 5 of teaching AP, you get this amount. 5 to 10 of teaching, you get another amount.
Yeah. So let me ask a question. Does the amount go up or down as you increase the number of years of teaching?
What do you
think? The answer would be up.
Even though it's easier in your 10th year of teaching.
This was negotiated last year with the MTA and the previous superintendent.
I mean, I think the other part of it is that we want to make Frontier the better community school, right? So we're going to have these AP classes to keep students at Frontier rather than going elsewhere.
I don't question AP classes at all, but every system that I've worked with and I've seen and I've been in has never paid a stipend for an AP. If you are certified to teach a subject matter, you teach that subject matter, basically whatever is assigned to you. So, and I'm not criticizing, what's negotiated is negotiated, it's a done, but that's the first time I've ever heard that. That's why I was curious about it.
He's gonna go back to teaching.
Yeah.
Are we in the second year of this contract also?
Yes.
Yep.
They're on the same negotiation cycle. And we do have, there's actually four contracts, two at the union level, two at the regional level, one for teachers and one for instructional assistants. So those are the only four union contracts that we
So it's
have.
A three-year cycle, and so next year.
We'll start negotiating again, and that would be for June of next year, I would assume.
Okay.
It goes retro in the first year.
Right, yeah. So that's always the hard budget year. Like this, the FY17 was the hard.
Yeah, 2.5% plus the 1%.
Because we had no idea what was going to be negotiated.
Right.
So it's hard to budget for that unknown year. So.
Actually, I feel good that we are in the second year because we'll be negotiating next year when I feel like the reality is we're going to be hitting the wall here.
We'll negotiate for the first year.
Yeah, well,
at zero, you'd be at 2.5% for a year, yes.
Well, we'll worry about it. I think we have to be more mindful when we go to negotiate this next round because the sustainability of what we're facing. But what is negotiated now is negotiated. So let's.
We actually won't negotiate until the following year, though. Yeah. We won't be negotiating next year.
Right, but. So the next year will hit. Then, right? Yeah, next year will hit. And then we'll be negotiating off of what I think will be the federal cutbacks.
Budget,
we will be seeing it.
This budget is the second year of the contract?
Mm-hmm. Okay. 18. So 19 will be the third year.
Yeah.
Who negotiates for the
town? Mr. Fajdukavich represents your board.
I guess my question is.
We kindly, people volunteer.
Nobody sees that as a problem?
Okay. Well.
Maybe our transplant.
Well. Anyway, let's move on. What's negotiated?
I'd just like to clear the air, though. Look, everybody deserves a raise at some point in time.
Yep.
Negotiations are always tough. You walk in, you do the best you can, both sides, and that. I understand it, I get it. I sat on the table, both sides, as an instructor and as an administrator, so I understand it. My concern as I looked at these budgets, though, is that, just off the top of my head and a quick look here, this is the first time I've seen this portion of Frontier budget, but I really did notice it in the elementary, is that I'm guessing probably somewhere around 90, 95%. Is personnel-related as far as the budget goes. So it's, when you look at that, and then all of a sudden, you know, you can't, you cannot address good teaching. But at the same time, it's that fine line of trying to be able to be realistic, and what's enough is enough. And my concern when I first looked at the elementary budget, I was saying, geez, you know, they've done a great job trying to control costs. But at the same time, when I looked at the instructional materials and that, I mean, some of those budgets are down to zero. And that's right. Why I say, is that something that we're realistically going to be able to sustain?
Right.
Are we trying to provide too many services, I guess, is what it comes down to. And I know there's a need there, but we're kind of walking the fine line. And it's a very difficult process, so I understand where everybody's coming from, but I really do believe that we really have to be aware of where we are with the town, not just the school budget, but the whole town, and how that fits together. You know, we got to remember that the school budget is not a standalone. You know, a lot of times we think it is, but it's not. It's all part of the big town budget, and to make everything work, there's going to be some flexibility there with all departments, including the school department. Sorry.
No, that's okay. I know people are all concerned.
Dan, can you explain on page 6, the total budget is $1,716,945.
Mm-hmm.
And if I turn to page 30, it seems different.
Page what?
30.
That's because it has the grants.
And what is that difference? Actually, you probably
30 of 36?
Efficiency.
30 of 36.
Yep. Yes.
716. 10,000,004.
17.
And it looks like the number 17. Is probably equal to the
well, on page 30, that's our revenue coming in.
Mm-hmm.
So hang on a second. Because I add the transportation, because I added the revolving transportation as a revenue source.
Well, the difference is $157,050.
Oh, I probably didn't make a correction.
And that's the excess and deficiency amount.
Right.
That we were applying.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So I should have changed the assessment to the town's number should go down to.
The 10,716.
8182.
How much?
Good catch. 7,581,842.
So what's the total Frontier budget?
10,716,945.
No, Frontier.
Yeah.
10,716,945.
10,716.
That's their operating budget.
That's what's assessed. But how much are they spending?
I can tell you that in a second.
Okay. That's what I had, but I wanted to make sure.
$10,916,380, because that we're taking $199,435 from the from school choice to pay for some salaries.
So where do I see that?
You don't. Our school committee meeting isn't till next week, so I'm trying to throw together something to give to you tonight to give you a little bit more detail than just the assessment.
Mm-hmm. No.
So it's not complete.
Yeah. Okay. So that final number, Patty, was 10,009,000?
16,380.
16,380. Thank you.
And then, and then we really should put our charter and choice expense on there too, which would increase it even more.
Right. Yeah.
So I will get that number and get back to Wendy to give to you that final number when I finish.
Could you just go over for me, Patty, the process when next year as Darius had stated, you know, the, it looks like these kids are coming up into Frontier and moving on, but then kids choice out to charter schools or whatever. How are the numbers adjusted? Like for us, say four kids go that we're being assessed for in the rolling enrollment charge, mm-hmm. and they end up going to charter school. How does the dollars hit us? You know, because that comes off a cherry sheet, the charter schools, and then how does that adjusted in the rolling enrollment number? It's not. Okay, so. When does our percentage?
Following year, it adjusts itself.
It adjusts, okay.
Because we have to have a stop point. So we use the October 1st for the 5-year rolling, because that's the, mm-hmm. it's in line with the foundation enrollment. Mm-hmm. So it just auto corrects, just like the foundation
right.
enrollment. You never
okay.
get an exact count, so you just have to take it in that point in space and time. And we say October 1st is the cutoff, and what's there
okay.
is there.
All right.
One more question. With the, there's a line item $35,784 to cover a lost state grant for summer services.
Mm-hmm.
What are those summer services?
Those summer services are partially academic for our incoming seventh graders, and also special education children who have IEP services. Oh, through the summer, so there is no regression.
Okay. All right. So that will be transferred to the budget as far as
correct.
Taxpayers picking that up.
Mm-hmm.
And as far as grants, far and few between, I know they're getting less and less as far as grants
right.
availability.
The federal entitlement grants, Title mm-hmm. I and 2A, which is our teacher professional development grant, as it's been predicted for our area that our population is decreasing, so did it come out for the Commonwealth of Mass at the last census, and that is what the entitlement numbers are based on
right.
and how they're allocated. So the Commonwealth of Massachusetts received less entitlement money from the federal government, and then they parse it out based on free and reduced lunch as well, and our population isn't that high.
Right.
So. Yes, they've been
availability,
decreasing and decreasing.
Right, yeah, it's decreasing, right.
right,
okay.
So we do receive some, but not
just
a
speak.
Lot.
Right. Not as readily as available as before.
Right.
Yeah.
Jump in. Two questions.
Sure.
Same thing, page 6.
Mm-hmm.
What's driving the increase in transportation?
Our special education. Our actual bus contract, we saved $20,000. But our special education children, because we're building capacity in the schools for specialized programs, we're bringing our kids to and from school. But some of them are so medically fragile that we also have to have an LPN transport with them. So that has never been budgeted, the stipends that we have to pay to transport the children if they need a one-on-one in the van with them, or in some cases it is an LPN, a licensed nurse that has to travel with the child.
We are getting reimbursed for that, aren't we?
If they're a school choice student, we do. If there are, no. There's
we don't. We can't apply.
Regional, no.
Oh,
it's specialized geez. Transportation. I mean, we do get a piece when we file the Medicaid.
I thought we joined that collaborative so that we could get reimbursed for medical costs.
So, it's so small, Carolyn. It's you know. I mean, we file it and we get as much as we can.
Yeah.
But the whole Medicaid administrative reimbursement program, they're really narrowing the focus of what we can claim and what we can't claim as well. But yes, I do in that reimbursement.
Question
I do include the cost of the monitors.
Okay.
And what are the insurances that are increasing?
So along with our salary increases, we also have the Medicare part of the FICA tax. That goes up based on salary. Our contribution to Franklin County is also based on the increased salaries.
And our health insurance this year went up 10.4% between the two types of policies. The combined increase was 10.4, and the dental went up 8%. And at Frontier, the employer bears 80% of that increase, and the employee 20%. So those basically are the insurances that have gone up. And our unemployment is based on our gross wages, and so as our wages increase, so don't these associated taxes and insurances.
But the, if I'm looking at it, approximately the wages are going up 69,000, 166,000. I'm looking at the top of page six. I wonder what that 145,000 is as a percentage of the salary increase. It looks like it's a pretty high percentage. And I haven't had a chance to do the numbers.
It's about 48%.
So you're saying Medicare, health?
Medicare, unemployment, the contribution to Franklin County. The retirement to Franklin County is going up, I believe, if you look on page six, about $34,000.
Yeah, but that's not in the 140.
No, you're right. It's not. It isn't. I broke that out separately.
I don't know. To me, it seems like
it is
disproportionate increase if it's all related to wages.
What, the insurance costs?
Yeah.
How many staff do you have?
Oh, well, and don't forget it's also central office.
Yeah.
So it's the staff you
health
see
insurance.
On page six. Is that what
it's probably
page five, 107.37, and then you have to add on also the central office people as well.
Yeah, no, John, that's 10%. Mm-hmm. I mean, your insurance, your health insurance is quite a good percentage.
What's our health insurance as a percentage of compensation? Do you know?
It's usually about a third.
Well, take your entire health insurance budget and multiply it by 10%, you're going to make a pretty good chunk of that money.
Yeah.
And we actually reasonable. Offer a stipend if you don't take our insurance. Mm-hmm. And
good. No, it's good, Pat.
No, it is, but what happened is like a year ago that we had 15 people that were taking advantage of that. Now I think we might have 4 people. So as private industry rates are going up, more people are migrating back to us. And one of the things that I have an issue with the Hampshire County Trust is that we offer this mid-level of employee plus one. It's a three-tiered system, single, employee plus one, and family. And that middle tier of employee plus one went away a long time ago in the private sector. And we can't control the cost, but I could control my enrollments if I didn't have that layer. Right. Because if you look at it, I look at it from the perspective, if I'm a young teacher and I'm just married, then my spouse gets a single plan at his employment and I get a single plan in mine. But because I have employee plus one, it's probably cheaper for me to take my husband with me on mine. And then on the flip side of that, once my children are grown, you would think that they would both go back to single plans. But again, we have single plus one, and a bunch of them migrate right back to that. So it's hard to control your enrollments.
So single plus one is gone.
It's not gone. Hampshire County still offers it.
They offer a three-tier plan.
Something to talk about next time
we
negotiate.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, that's Hampshire County. I don't know that that's something that they'd have to
negotiate with them.
Yeah, but I mean that might be something actually a discussion that we've never had with them on that. I mean, that's a really good observation, Patty.
I've tried to bring it up with them, Carolyn, when we meet right here in these halls, and they don't like that. I say that.
We had 4 years.
I'm not very popular, Carolyn.
That's okay.
Right, 4 years. They had 4 years. They didn't increase the rates at all.
That's true. But now they have in the 2 years. Last year it was 7%, 8%. This year it's 10. So it's an 18% increase over 2 years.
Yep.
So when you talk about going to the negotiation table and offering your teachers 2.5 when they're getting a 10% increase in their health insurance, it's a hard bargaining chip.
What's your percentage for your insurance?
80-20.
I said, yeah. What is your percentage?
Right.
And you're saying, you know, the town people get 65.
Right.
Sunderland gets 50.
Right.
I mean,
No, Sunderland's up to 55.
Oh, they're up to 55.
Yeah.
We're trying to negotiate that one.
But then we go back to regionalization, and they say, well, wait a minute, why would we? We're paying more.
Well, that's part of contract negotiations. If you go to regionalization, that's part of your negotiation.
Mm-hmm.
Correct.
But you could do it K-6 region, not necessarily K-12.
No, we're talking about a K-6, and
That's what we're talking about.
Sunderland, well, other towns that pay less than the 80% that...
We all pay less.
We all do.
Yeah, we all do.
But the four towns don't pay the same. I think Conway's at 70-30, you guys are at 65-35, Sunderland's 45-55. Who am I forgetting? Waitley? I don't know where Waitley is off the top of my head.
They came down, though, a couple of years ago.
I think they did. I think they might be 60-40 as well.
Is there any deductible upfront? You know, like first 500 is paid by the employee, so the insurance kicks in with the first dollar?
Mm-hmm. Yep. It's a very generous plan as well.
Sounds like it.
Our office visits and the office visits are still $15. I mean, there's not many insurances that you see that with, and I mean the copays are very low.
Who wouldn't?
So there's not a lot of incentive for the employees
not to take it.
To
go to the Medicare.
Not go to the doctor.
Well,
so
you want
the more
them,
the more they go to the
to.
Doctor,
right.
The more
they
you know, they're
mean,
not,
right.
they're, there's no money coming out of their pockets,
right.
Roughly speaking.
Well, hopefully
so
they're not
that's
going to
drive
room.
Up the claims. Which
right,
is going to drive
the utilization.
Up the insurance
costs. Right, the utilization is what drives the rates. But you would hope that just like we want to get our kids in early, preventative care is what we want our employees to do. We want them to go have well visits rather than not go and then find out they have a catastrophic illness that's going to cause our utilization rates to go through the roof. So, I mean, it is sort of a fine line there.
If I could cut over the... some of the data that you've got. If I could, I've got a couple of questions. On page 29, you've got enrollment figures by town.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm assuming that the 2016, that's the October 1 enrollment.
Correct.
And so we're showing 467, and you earlier, the number that I saw for enrollment was 611.
But that includes school choice?
Yes. Do we have approximately 140 kids in school
mm-hmm.
choice?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay.
So we're down. If we're flipping over to the assessment pages, that starts mm-hmm. at 29. So dropping out the year 2011 and bringing in the year 2016, we're down 72 students.
Mm-hmm.
The bulk of that is basically... Conway is the loser in this year's assessment because their population didn't drop. In fact, it increased, and everyone else has stayed the same or decreased. So when we look at the assessment rates, Conway went up significantly, Deerfield went up slightly, and Sunderland and Waitley went down.
So, I'll leave that alone. If I could... Looking through, what I couldn't quite pick out the number that you're asking the towns to pay into the, in other words, what's it going to cost Deerfield?
So if you go to page 32 of 36.
Yep.
And you go down the Deerfield column,
mm-hmm.
and you look at the FY18 combined assessment, it would be $3,645,579, or an increase of 3.32% from last year.
Okay.
And that was, this was higher, it was up to 5.94%.
Yes, I did see that.
And the subcommittee and the school committee, upon the recommendation, we took half of what was available in our excess and deficiency and applied it to the budget in order to reduce the assessments, which is what I was making the adjustments for, the 157,050.
Mm-hmm.
So that was half of the excess and deficiency that was available to the school committee. They applied to the budget to reduce the assessments.
So what you will have left in your excess and deficiency?
$157,050.
Plus anything that you might from this year's budget.
Right, well, that won't, we won't have, we won't be able to touch that until it's certified.
Right.
Do you all feel comfortable with that amount? I mean, that's a fairly low amount for them to carry.
For true.
Should we retain more, you was trying to say?
Well, I
5.7% or whatever the number was.
It's still two and a half.
I know, I'm
just. Two and a half.
Yeah.
I know, but I'm just saying, is they are cutting it close. There isn't that, I mean, they, until their new amount is certified, it will be certified in September, so.
Is that just,
you know, actually, Carolyn, we didn't get certified until February, even though I filed by the deadline.
Why was it so late?
Because the towns, I guess, all the towns needed to go first because they needed to get their tax rate set. So all the regionals got pushed to the end of the line. So I believe I did not get ours certified. And then it was, the process was more like a colonoscopy this year. They looked at everything. So I had to keep submitting data and submitting data and submitting data.
You want to explain that a little more?
I think it's self-explanatory. February 2nd is the date that they finally certified our free cash.
Wow. I mean, that's really slow.
It is.
I have to say.
I mean, our deadline is October 31st, and it was in there by October 17th. I did not wait till the final day of the of the deadline.
And they had to do all the counts first.
You all have been on the school committee for quite a while. I mean, when have you felt? I mean, have you felt that the numbers for is that enough? I mean, do you feel like that's enough based on what's happened in the past?
Yeah.
No.
The excess and deficiency.
No.
No. The excess and
I'm just saying, right. Yeah, I'm just saying that we have to be mindful that, you know, when we cut these budgets, I mean, legitimately we need to make cuts and not just cut down, I don't know. I mean,
well, we didn't cut the budget.
No, I know, Bruce. So, I mean, but I'm just saying that when you don't legitimately cut the budget and you're just putting in excess, your excess capacity.
I think the people in the know that sit on the school committees and the administration of those schools, the elementary and frontier, work very hard to bring these numbers down, and they know what they're doing.
Exactly.
And I know it's not a comfortable thing for them to do. It's very difficult, but as I said before, I mean, even and I think they did a good job bringing the numbers where they are, but even then, we're still over 2.5% on both budgets. And once again, when you look at the overall budget, you're looking at roughly about 70% for the schools out of the town budget, and it puts all the other departments within the town. And I'm not trying to butt heads or anything here. That's not what this is all about. I'm trying to. It's got to all fit, and we only have X amount of dollars in revenue,
Jeff,
and to make that fit. So, you know, we could be saying the same thing to every department. Do you have enough money in that? You know, and everybody's trying to do the best they can, I think. But at the same time, you know, we're supposed to be living within a 2.5% increase.
I'm not disagreeing, Jeff. I'm just saying that.
Carolyn, can I just tell you a little bit what the subcommittee and the school committee discussed as far as that? I think the biggest concern is the state of our building, because the regional agreement, as Mr. Decker said, is insufficient in as far as dealing with school choice and charter, because it didn't exist when the charter when the regional agreement. Right. Address capital request assessments, so we can't assess you for capital improvements. And our building is in need of some capital improvements. So the school committee felt that if we gave half, and then we may be coming forward, and we're waiting for one more meeting, which is next Tuesday, we may have a major repair to the roof that needs to be done. And if we applied this and then possibly come forward with a warrant article for the four towns to do a borrowing to repair the roof.
All right.
What part of the roof is that?
It's the one that we were discussing with you, Mr. Camosa, the library media center. So the subcommittee gave Mr. Lesko $6,000 to have a professional person come in and look at the scope of the project. And that report is due to come back to the full committee on Tuesday night as to what the scope of the project needs to be done.
We'll present it Tuesday night.
I just make a comment. Jeff, I'm kind of new to all this, but just a comment on what you're saying about having a budget over 2.5%. I mean, if you have salaries that are due with the contract, it pays us 2.5%, it's going to be next to impossible to get a budget.
Oh, I hear you.
2.5%.
I hear you. That's why I said with negotiations, it's a fine line. It's very difficult. And I'm not trying to criticize. I'm just saying it's a fine line. People have to be aware of how it's coming about and that. In all due respect, and I really appreciate you being involved and getting involved. I would love to see more people in your age bracket get involved with the town, to be truthful. You know, us old timers are getting pretty old here, but you know, so please don't get discouraged. I'm just saying that when you take everything in account, it really puts the pressure on that. And as I said, I know that's a fine line because people do deserve acknowledgement, especially when they're working hard and that. It's not to downplay anybody or anything. It's a reality, but at some time we need to have a reality check, and it's a tough conversation. I don't feel comfortable having this conversation. As a former educator, believe me, it's a very difficult thing for me to bring out publicly. I don't feel comfortable with it, but I think it needs to be done because I sit on a finance committee and we're looking at all the other departments and all the other needs in this town. You know, there's a lot of things that we're facing that, you know, maybe public's not aware of it. Maybe people in schools sitting on different committees aren't aware of it. But, you know, we're facing major, could be facing some major costs with two wastewater treatment plants. I mean, we're talking millions. You know, right now what's being projected is like $32 million. Show me in the count of the town of Deerfield where we have that $32 million. And I realize we can bond and borrow and that, but once again, we put ourselves back in the same situation that we had with the town garage. You know, we have a discussion about a grant for the public library. And granted, even after a grant, taxpayers can be facing $4 million. Where's that $4 million coming from? We don't have it, not in any account that we have. You talk about work that needs to be done on the school building, and I agree, we should take care of our buildings. We don't even have a capital improvement stabilization fund. It's being discussed, but we don't have anything in there. We had a little over $100,000 that came to the capital improvement committee here that was approved. But where's the money coming from? That's going to have to go to the town floor, town meeting. Basically, we have not done a good job in long-term planning, and we need to be setting some money aside besides trying to pay for all these things too. So I understand the school budget, I get it, and it is. It's a very difficult task. It's a fine line.
The issue really isn't the budget. The issue, and you know, we deal with it, but you don't see it, is the limitations that the state places on our ability to increase taxes.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You hit
a ceiling.
You know, I've gone through the calculations with Patty and I think several others, and you start with taking what you raised last year and you add 2.5% to it.
That's it.
And that's it.
And any new growth.
And you don't have a lot of new growth.
Right.
So it's like zero.
Now, and at some point in time, you know, we've talked about it, selectmen, and they're the ones that have to put it on the ballot, have been reluctant and so far. But I think the time is coming where we're going to have to talk about a 2.5 overlay.
But I don't think that you're the only town in that.
Well,
I mean, Proposition 2.5 came in what year?
And 1980.
So, and since 1980, have you had to do an override?
We've done some dancing.
Only debt exclusions.
We put it in debt exclusion.
Right.
We've hit it in debt exclusion.
But what I'm saying.
In a way, that's not all bad.
Right.
Right, that's not all bad.
Because this was in 1980, I think a lot of cities and towns are facing the same dilemma, that what was okay in 1980 isn't going to work in 2018 and going forward.
I just want to point out to all of you here, is this budget does not contain any money to put aside for the reserves that we need for the retired employees, the cost that the federal government now makes us, says we have to include in our balance sheets. And that is several million dollars.
What, do you know, what is your pet?
9 million, Carolyn. We just, this was the year we had to be reevaluated with our, we had to redo all our employees' data, and we're, I think it's upwards of $9 million right now.
Oh, my God.
And we have $100,000 that we are investing in the trust fund that we, the school committee appropriated from a prior budget. But getting back to the excess and deficiency, I think the only other wild card besides the building repairs is the number of children that do appear for us at seventh grade. Mr. Modesto has some issues that we may need another staffing person if we get a certain number of those seventh graders more than we anticipated.
Well, I was just worried, you know, given the what a special need costs now are, I was worried that if you just got one or two special need kids that you had not anticipated, you would suck up your money.
It would.
And that's why I was worried.
So,
I mean, so, I mean, I'm not criticizing, I mean,
no,
I'm certainly appreciative that you were trying to bring the budget closer to the 2.5, which we really have tried to get everyone to toe the line to. But, you know, by putting your excess and deficiency money in, it's not a true budget cut per se. I mean, you're just kicking the can down the road a little. I know, we're balancing our budget on free cash every year ourselves, so.
So we have a little contingency built into the school choice this year, because we weren't supposed to have any money this year. We were supposed to be upside down. So we want to be very conservative in case the same projection comes out. So there is some money in the school choice fund that the school committee has put aside to not spend in case we need an additional staff member for middle school, or we get an expensive sped placement.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure, because you don't have the same ability to come back and raise money in a special town meeting. So, well, you can, but it's
right.
just
it's
much more difficult.
I hope I represented Mary for the finance subcommittee well. Okay.
All right. No, it was just my question, because I was just worried.
It's the exact number Mr. Decker just found is $9,287,712 is our OPEB liability.
You should have got a copy of this.
I think I, you know, try to blank those numbers out.
Question on the health insurance for retirees. What's the percentage of
50%?
50-50.
It's 50-50.
Yeah, it's the same as we have.
I think all the towns are 50-50. Although I did just find out that Whately only pays 50% of a single plan, which is different because we pay 50% of whatever plan they're enrolled in. So they just pay 50% of the single plan, because so they're only paying for the employee, not the plus one or the family part.
Frontier used to do that.
That's what we were doing.
Yeah. Well, there's no written policy, Mr. Decker. It's one of the things that we're going to come forward with, hopefully, working on some parameters.
We
pay 50% of whatever they select.
Okay.
I have a question on page 15, utility services. I know this year you're going to be invoice for sewer use, and your budget has only increased about $1,300 over what's actually spent in 16. Where are you? Page 15 of 36.
Underwater and sewer?
Yes.
We paid 13,000 and right.
It would have just been water.
Right, water.
Point.
Right.
Your base rate that you're charged, you could be looking at another $9,000 in sewer fees.
I was under the impression that you were paying something in sewer.
So we were. I found an invoice last year where we paid $3,600 in one shot.
Well, it should be $9,000 next year.
Okay.
Same with the elementary school.
Now, you do have an outside meter, Patty, because we were concerned about the water bill. So there was a separate meter installed. So did you take that consideration, Bruce?
Yes, when I called the water department, they don't read the second water meter. They bill off the first water meter. They don't care.
Oh, okay.
It's water used, how it's used. The town and the school needs to read their second meter, give us a difference in bill.
Okay.
Not just what we have been doing for years, is assuming a flat stated use for the Frontier School of about 1 million gallons a year.
They used to deduct it.
They don't.
So, Patty, you will need someone to read the meters then. Bruce, when...
Does someone from the town do that?
No, the town reads the water meter that will give you your water bill.
You should have Bob Lesko go in.
Yeah.
Every time they read the regular meter, take the camera, go in, take a picture of it.
Yeah.
Read the second meter?
Read the second meter.
So it's deducted.
And who would he send that, and who would we send that to?
Town clerk. Barbara Hancock.
And probably send it to the water department.
And how many times is the meters read?
Twice a year.
Twice, April and October.
That'll help.
And I don't think the schools are for a long time. I think we're in that situation.
All the public buildings are the same. The elementary school is about $6,000.
Okay.
That's a slight one listed for abatement application.
No, no abatements.
I had to do that once in another city that I worked in because our sewer bill, it was just an anomaly and it went right up. And the school committee said, go to the water department and then file for an abatement. It was the harshest thing I've ever been through.
I think it's good that Frontier does have two meters. That makes a lot of sense because they do...
They do water a lot.
A lot of water outside, but the elementary school does.
But we have, I think we also have two different water services.
I don't think so.
Pumping that Bloody Brook?
We do it too much.
Bloody Brook.
We had to replace the...
Feeding off the house next door.
A couple of years ago, 4 or 5 years ago. And I think when it broke and the water was getting fed through from North Main Street, so...
There was a double line to Frontier. There was a backup line.
What's that?
There is a backup line to Frontier. It meets the same spot.
It meets the same spot, goes through the same meter, that's fine.
Okay, so...
I know there was two different locations that was coming in.
Just in case.
So does anyone have any more questions? I wanted just to make sure we had a little bit of time to discuss. No one wants to stay here late, but I did want to discuss the formula is changing, or they're going to address the changing of the formula for Chapter 70, the legislature. And I wanted to make sure we were involved somehow, writing letters. And when I asked the question on Friday of our legislators, I didn't get a clear answer. But the answer was, well, let us know that you're interested. So my intention tonight is that we need you all to give us a sort of like a draft letter that we can gin up. And I think all four towns select boards should be sending letters saying that we're interested. And I don't know how else to participate. I've been trying to figure out how... Michael Bonacani from Mohawk has been trying to put this group together.
He's had a meeting tonight,
yeah.
I believe.
Carolyn, I can envision you with a picket sign down at the State House.
There has been a
Carolyn,
meeting.
Carolyn, what exactly did they discuss with you on Friday about the...
Well, they indicated that this is coming because I knew it was coming because I had talked to Mike what was about 3 months ago.
Right.
And so, because I wanted to make sure that we had some kind of advocacy and that we were active in the process, because if the process is going to be skewed against us if we don't participate. So my intention was to be very vocal and participate and organize some kind of, you know, group that was on top of this constantly. So,
but what changes are? I mean, I know a couple of years ago they had the whole foundation commission
budget review
that reviewed how, and the only things I thought were coming out of that is that they were going to change the way they funded. They were going to make adjustments for the different levels of SPED and also the recognize the severe increases that we are experiencing in healthcare costs.
Well, supposedly that, but there was also some indication that decreasing enrollment was going to be less. We were going to get less penalized in the formula for decreasing enrollment. And what else did they talk about?
Well, definitely on Mike Bonacani's thing, they were talking a lot about rural schools and how our costs are so much greater. And it's definitely a Cape Cod thing, and it's a Western Mass thing. It's, you know, it's not Wellesley. It's not Wellesley. There was a meeting tonight, I think, that was happening. Massachusetts Association of School Committees had a hearing that I went to at a Delaney House a couple weeks ago, and that was kind of starting to kind of put together some plans. I'm not sure if the collaborative is also working on ways that we could address it. So they're starting to have these hearing tours coming around, and we do need to get involved, or else no one will listen to us, and it'll just go by the wayside. There is zero money this year.
It's not for this next coming year, but it's next year after that. And if we don't participate, then we're not going to have an advantage on the formula. And in the past, we've been so, with climate change, we've had so many issues with repair of our infrastructure, our roads and culverts and stuff like that. And the Cape is a kind of a match in a similar situation for us. So I've coordinated with Cape Cod selectmen and tried to, organize stuff. And we've been successful in getting some appropriations and some money towards, upgrading. And so not all the costs, these storm costs, are borne by us as a town. And, we've reached out with other programs like NRCS and stuff like that, but we don't need to get into that. But what I'm trying to do is capitalize on our relationship that I have with the Cape Cod Selectmen's Association, because we coordinate our Franklin Selectmen's Association and the Berkshire Selectmen's Association. What we try to do is lobby the three of our counties together and go after what we need, because if you have legislators from the Cape and out here and we get sign them on and we activate, then we have a little bit more weight to counteract activity that's happening in the eastern part of the state, outside Boston and stuff. So I just wanted to coordinate and take advantage. I was looking at it. Right.
So
we need to do something.
So my understanding is that he's been also connecting with other smaller towns.
Yes.
Before the Golden Beltway, the 128, exactly. But in other towns, and the meetings have been taking place there. Tonight there was one at 5:00, and there was one at 6:00 at Mohawk. I was at a meeting probably in November with, I think there were 20 superintendents around the table and Senator Rosenberg. He actually had tried to put something through the legislature, a different program, a different kind of vision on it. And so far that hasn't been successful. And the other consideration that we're up against is there's the Urban Schools Coalition, there's the rural schools, and then there's another coalition, and I don't know, I can't think.
Suburban schools.
Yeah, that's, no, that's what it is, Ken. It's the Suburban Schools Coalition. So everyone's putting together.
Well, that's why we got to organize.
Yeah, because, you know, and we certainly have the need here because of our declining enrollment. We're getting the same as an urban school with, and I am following it. The next step, I understand, will be eventually, as we come together, there might be a little financial fee to become part of this so that they can use that money to put us all together and really advocate heavily. And I keep track on that. I meet with the Franklin County superintendents, which Mike Bonacani is a member of. I meet with them once a month, and he keeps us informed. And unfortunately, I had it on my calendar to go tonight, but I needed
exactly
to be here.
Well, what is distressing to me, because when we talk about sustainability, is when I first was a selectman, we were around 30%. The state picked up the cost of educating kids. It's down to, I don't know what it is this year, but we were down to, what, 21% last year. Yeah. So, I mean, that 10% makes a huge difference, and it's being picked up locally. And that's a huge cost that we're
pulled away from the other departments.
Mm-hmm. And so we got to figure out ways that we can lobby and get more money, because that is one of the things that's happening. The trend is happening, and it's no one's fault. I'm here in this room, but it is a trend, and it's disgusting because the state is paying less and they're mandating more, and you know, it's just the paperwork, having to file the paperwork is a huge cost, and we need to organize. And I was hoping that we could figure out a way that we have constant letters going out, and we want to say that we want to participate in the Chapter 70 reform formula process, and that we actually carpool or whatever. Yeah. When we start,
we got to show up.
Yeah. We got to show up to these meetings, and it really is worth it. I wanted to take advantage of our connections on the Cape and try to connect with people on the Cape and make sure we pull in the Berkshires. And,
that kind of lobbying does work.
It does.
For instance, just last week, the Chinese Immersion School, they wanted to open up 429 new seats. They wanted to develop a high school. And there were so many districts that voiced, as well as our own Darius Podesto, Amherst, Pelham, all of them that voiced their concern over it, that even though they allowed 3 new charter schools in the state, they did not allow that. The problem, they did not allow the expansion of the Chinese. The problem is they might come back right away next month, and then my job at this point will be to step up and go to my school committees and ask them to help us craft a letter too.
Yeah, we just need to be more political, and I know that sounds... You know,
if you want something to do, there's a Foundation Budget Review Commission, findings in progress, the 9th of March, which is Thursday night, in Marlborough, if you want to take a ride.
That was the second.
I have a pipeline meeting that night.
Well, which is more important, the pipeline or the budget?
It's not the pipeline.
That's the second version of the one that I went to locally.
The pipeline was dead.
They sent another email out today.
Yes.
I know. Oh, my God. I'm out every night.
But if we come together, we have, some letters from our school committees and selectmen, and we just keep hammering our elected officials.
So what I was asking for is guidance on letters that we could send, and that if you could regularly give us a kind of, template letter that, and I will make sure I'll harass the other 3 towns, and we'll, at least from our district, we will be constantly sending stuff out.
Isn't it ironic, though, excuse me for a second, that here we are talking about funding, and we're talking about Western Mass and the Cape and being kind of skewed and getting the short end of the stick. Isn't it funny that those 2 areas are the areas that are involved with school choice and the other areas aren't?
That's true.
That's true.
Isn't that interesting?
Very, very true.
And that's one of the things I felt very strongly we should lobby for, because school choice, when we accepted school choice, it was $5,000 a student. Here we are, years later.
20 years later.
It's still $5,000 a kid, and there's been no adjustment,
and that's
gross.
The other thing that annoys me about that is that charter is choice, So why aren't we funding all our choices the same way?
Absolutely.
So if charter's being funded a different way than school choice, that's not right. If they're both choices for parents, and I agree there should be, but let's fund them the same.
Yeah.
Well, it just, it irritates me when we're spending, we're struggling to cover $15,000 a student and telling you to cut, and then we're have no control, and we're spending 20-plus thousand.
Taxation without representation.
Sending it out the door.
And now the private school vouchers that'll be coming out.
Maybe.
I thought I saw on the recorder.
There was a shot across your.
A week ago or so.
Easy.
Sorry, Mr. Cutterback.
I thought I saw on the recorder a week or so ago an ad to one of the towns around here, I don't know, it was Waitley.
It was.
Saying that they are welcoming school choice.
You'll see that from now through.
Why?
August.
Because they're.
Well, actually.
Otherwise, they won't be able to offer the program.
Let me just say this. We had to run an ad because in Waitley, we're expanding our preschool from half day to full day, and we wanted to advertise that. So we figured we'd kill two birds with one stone and advertise the full day elementary, the full day pre-K program and openings. Waitley is our lowest population town. And right now, I believe, well, Conway too. Right now, Conway's got 4 children enrolled in kindergarten, and I believe Waitley has 7 children.
Talk about consolidation.
7 children enrolled in kindergarten. So we need school choice in Waitley because we only have 7 children.
But when we talk about that, Trevor, that's when those small towns get very nervous.
Well, they all need to come together. They're not going to be sustainable. Mm-hmm. I mean, we all aren't going to be sustainable unless we come together and find a way to.
Area.
I could sell them.
Well, I mean, actually,
I went up and cleaned up on Sunday.
They may abdicate. I'm just kidding.
Did you say abdicate?
Yeah. To speak to.
To succeed from.
Yeah. Right. Oh, that's the word I meant. Yeah. I'm watching a lot of.
You're watching The Crown.
I'm watching the Crown in Victoria. Oh, I'm sorry. I may abdicate because of my embarrassment. To speak to Waitley, the principal there will have numbers for us, I believe, in April or May or later this month as to which classes, though. They don't just open the doors wide open. They are very mindful of filling in spots in classes. They only have one class of each grade, and they're very mindful to make sure that those class sizes don't go too high. It's not just anybody that can come in.
But their ratio to natives to the whole population is substantially different than Deerfield.
Yes, that would be their demographics.
Leaving sixth grade and moving to the seventh grade, the numbers that come from Deerfield, Sunderland, Waitley, and Conway versus Sunderland, Deerfield, Waitley, and Conway have to contribute to the Frontier budget. I suspect that it's skewed substantially.
Well, we went over that earlier.
If you look at page 27 of 36 in the Frontier packet, I listed out by town the number of students and the dollar amounts by town. So school choice, Conway sends 6. Charter, they send 10 for a total of 16. Deerfield,
what page?
27 of 36.
And on which side of the page?
The left-hand side is the number of students, and the right-hand side is the amount of money.
I see, yep.
So in Deerfield, 15 students are choicing out at the 7 through 12 level. And 17 are going to charter for 32 from Deerfield. Sunderland has 11 choice out and 8 charter out for a total of 19. And Waitley has 8 choice out and 7 charter out for a total of 15.
Wow. A lot of money.
So yes. We are going to be expending, I think this is FY17. Our charter and choice tuition out is $1,009,615.
Mm-hmm. Almost half of that's from here.
So that's why we need choice, so that we don't have to assess that to the town.
Well, the thing is, though, that those choice youngsters come in, and by the time they get up to high school, there's no way that Frontier can provide an education for $5,000 a piece.
Mm-hmm. Agreed.
You certainly, it does help at the elementary level.
Well,
Because of the fact you're filling the classroom.
But it also helps here, because if we have school choice income, then I don't have to assess the towns that $1 million. Because it's netting out, and we only use whatever's left to either use for funding or use to budget.
I would assume that the staffing would be reduced over time.
For 148 children?
Well, I mean, so...
It wouldn't be $1 million worth of cuts.
Well, you first you got to reduce, so right now we have 146. We got 82 going out. So you got to drop that number immediately. So now you're talking about 11 students per class. Now you got the charter component, which is 3-to-1. I get 4 kids, make up every one I get, you know, because we made $20,000 going out, $5,000 ahead. You start talking about how that kind of runs out. The numbers don't just add up of, you know, you're upside down there. And then as soon as you cut programs, so,
oh, I know.
And that's what we did when we called
it doesn't,
the budget.
It doesn't make sense.
They keep going out.
You can't, right. I know.
You lose more than the charter and choice by cutting programs.
I was just going to say.
The real charter.
We're in that game. It's like change the rules of the game.
And Sunderland, I think Sunderland is also a good example of that, because when they're 2.5 override failed and the budget had to be reduced, everybody chartered and choiced out. Right now in Sunderland at the elementary level, we have nobody chartering and choicing out at the elementary level in Sunderland.
Wow.
Oh, yeah.
That's huge.
Because we were able to bring the programs back. So the parents are staying.
That makes a huge difference. Well, if there's no more questions, I just want to say thank you very much for everybody for coming. It was very productive. I hope we can continue discussions. We'll see how our budgets work out. It really is.
I'd also like to say thank you to everybody and appreciate your efforts on all the things you're involved with.
Yep.
Thank you.
I know it seems sometimes really hard, but we're all in this together, truly. And we all support education. It's just, it's really hard to balance the budget. And and quite frankly, we're balancing the budget on free cash ourselves. So we're just worried. I'm worried because when we had the 2008 budget cycle, it was actually 2009, but we had a deficit of $300,000, and that was really awful. And I feel like next year, just based on conversations that I've had with our legislators and, you know, watching the federal budget, and just even though it looks like the Medicaid waiver is expansion isn't going to get pulled to 2020, but which is only another extra budget year away, but... you know, that is $1 billion on the state budget.
A billion.
Just that little portion of it, not the whole other stuff. And, you know, there's no state growth of $1 billion. So that $1 billion cut is coming down to us on the local level. And that's freaking me out, because even though we're really lucky we don't get a lot of state aid, it's going to have huge impact. And, I mean, I would foresee us having a cut of $300,000 to $400,000 at least. In local aid. It just has to be, because the way the numbers look. And, you know, I brought that up Friday because we just can't absorb it. You know, we're trying to keep us down at 2.5% because that's all we have. We really don't have any new growth. And it just, it was so awful back in 2009 when we had half of that money to shortfall. And I just we're not addressing the OPEB. I mean, I can't believe the $9 million. I mean, but we're hanging over our heads on the elementary school level is probably a couple million. And it's very tough to think about those numbers, because there's just no wiggle room. We've been cutting and cutting. Every single year that I've been a select board member, the first Mitt Romney made 9 seat cuts my first year, and he stopped paying on the elementary school. That was one of the 9 seat cuts.
That was never supposed to happen.
That was never supposed to happen. That was a contract we have with the state. They were going to pay our share, you know, the amount, the matching amount for the elementary school, and they didn't pay that year. And fortunately, the 9C cuts that the Governor Baker made, I mean, he's very mindful, because he was a selectman
right.
before, so he's very mindful of the impact on the local level. So his 9C cuts this past year for the revenue shortfall were all on the state level. He made no local aid cuts. But I just don't see how we're not going to have huge shortfalls. And it just, the committees that I'm on the state level, everybody's freaking out because the money is seriously short.
And that's why we budget the regional transportation so conservatively, because that is always
yeah.
subject to a 9C cut.
Right.
Yeah.
So isn't the reimbursement level on the charter tuition aid.
Yep.
Yeah.
So it's hard for us to say how much we have in school choice and charter, because those are things that could get cut in December.
I know. Yep.
So
when do you go out for new contract?
For
transportation.
20. We're through 19.
So I'm hearing two things important. Number one, that we're all politically active.
Yeah.
But
need to be.
Number two, that we're looking for different partners, right? That you talked about
mm-hmm.
Cape.
Yeah.
That we don't get marginalized into rural, because if we're just rural,
mm-hmm.
people in Boston are going to say, well, there's no growth in rural, so you don't need the money.
But it's,
we're
but,
diminished at that point.
Well, what it is numbers. So you have legislators. Fortunately, our legislative delegation is very good.
Strong.
I mean, we have strong representation. We have Stan Rosenberg and Steve Kulik, he's vice chair again of the
yeah,
Ways and Means Committee. And we have really, Paul Mark is really good.
Mm-hmm.
But they're not enough.
Yeah.
And so that's why reaching out to the Cape and making sure we have every single Berkshire representative as well is really important.
Mm-hmm.
And the Mount Washington select board member is president of the Mass Selectmen's Association this year, and he's really good. And we know, I mean, I've worked with him well over a decade, so he's going into Boston every month and a couple times a month, and we're in communication on a regular basis. So.
He
knows.
Gets it, that
yeah.
Not
yeah.
just to call it rural, that we have to all be
right.
involved.
Right.
You know,
and so, but just we have to lobby and be politically active and say we're interested and keep the pressure on, because, and the reason why I say letters, and then we should have like a email list that say please make phone calls too, because it's 5 phone calls. If any legislator gets or the governor gets more than 5 phone calls on an issue, then they know it's an issue. So it's really important to call, and it's really important to have letters. Emails is not so much, because yeah, they delete them kind of, and it's not the same. But it's not hard to make a phone call, and you just have a list and you call and but we have to have talking points, because you have to, it's very important to be consistent, and it's very important to have talking points. And that's where I was coming to Lynn and Patty. They need to do templates and to pass out talking points on a regular basis, so that we are active, because it stuff is not right. It's not right that the state is paying us 20% of the cost of raising a student. You know, I mean, we had this big protest. It was years ago, but and that was coming from like 35% or 34%, and we went down to 30%, and everyone got together, and we had this huge protest. You must remember that, Mary and Ken. And we had all these meetings, and, oh, okay, then they put more money into it.
Probably before my time.
No, it wasn't. We were definitely younger. I mean, we had kids
yeah.
that were in
Excuse
elementary
me,
school.
Sure.
Yes, yes. But
sure.
the main thing is we have to have some talking points, and it would be really important for us to get those passed out and to be more organized and be more participatory.
Mm-hmm.
So that we just don't roll over for these cuts.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Please, nobody say the word mosquito.
It's coming.
I do want to mention that we are monitoring one of the areas of concern is the habitat in around the Frontier area and the elementary school. There are about 50 mosquito species, but there's only 4 or 5 that we have to be really concerned of. Most of them are nuisance. And it's four or five of them that have the potential of a... You trap them. You trap them. We've been trapping them. We trapped them last summer, and we're going to trap them again this year. But anyway, the viral load of four or five species is of a concern, and we are working on a way of notifying you and staying in communication.
We're in the car.
And that if there's issues, then we'll...
Wow, you can't underestimate Zipka. I mean, not that we have it, but...
Well, Tripoli is what we're concerned about.
Yes, definitely.
And that will impact sports schedules and practice schedules and stuff like that, if we have that kind of stuff. Or West Nile. West Nile is circulating, but most kids don't have a problem with West Nile, per se. You know, we'll just... If we pick it up, we can tell people to use, you know, mosquito repellent, that kind of stuff. But anyway, thank you, everybody.
Thank you.